Some days you're the windshield, some days you're the bug is supported in part by U-Cubed Body, Mind, Spirit.
Okay, good. Let's go do it again. That's the part I like the best. And these are just announcements. Hello, good evening, Berks County. Welcome back. My name is Elizabeth E.J. Jackson, but you can call me E.J. And the name of this program is Some Days You're the Windshield, and Some Days You're the Bug. What that means is some days you're clear and clean and can see to the horizon and nothing stands in your way. And then some days you're the bug, which means you're fragmented, you're going nowhere, and you're all over the place. And our goal is to be windshields more than bugs tonight. Now, I'm seeing in the monitor that it looks as though I'm wearing orange, but actually I'm have red, white, and blue. I'll get this right, head, shoulders, knees, and toes, for the holiday, because we have a Memorial Day holiday coming up this weekend. So enjoy yourself, and hopefully you will take a little bit of what we have to offer here tonight into your weekend. So without any further ado, let's go right to the announcements. And as always, our first announcement is just to say this is a little girl's creation, and this is for Madeline, my granddaughter, Madeline Scheffler. And Grammy loves you always and forever. You're always in my heart. Our next full moon is Tuesday, May the 29th. It's the flower moon, and it will be fullest at 10:20 a.m. And as always, when there's a full moon, I encourage you to go out under the full moon and say, fill it up, fill it up, fill it up. Open your wallet, open your purse, just open your arms and just say, fill it up, fill it up, fill it up. And guaranteed, something good will come into your life over the next 30 days after you do that. But you can also go, ar, 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 if you want to before you say fill it up. It's always good to howl at the moon, isn't it? Absolutely. So we have another announcement here, and this is the class of 1968, Holy Name High School. We're having our 50th class reunion on Saturday, June the 2nd, 2018. Yay! Everybody's cheering about that. Good times, good memories, good friends. There's a picture of some of us up there, and I brought along some little things to show you here. So let me show you the goodies that we have on the table here to celebrate the HNHSers from 68. We have the yearbook, there we go, and the hat, our class hat. We didn't get a jacket, we got a class hat. And this beautiful picture that's inside of some of my lovely friends, not only from high school, but also from grade school. We're a very tight crew, and there's going to be a lot of fun that day. I'm not going to tell you where it's going to be, because I don't want outsiders showing up. This is only for people from Holy Name High School. So, with that being said, let's go back to the regular announcements from the PowerPoint. And we have Becoming an Underwriter. Support BCTV. BCTV is a wonderful community fixture, and we need to utilize it, we need to support it, and we encourage you to become an underwriter for any of the programs on BCTV. If you don't want to become an underwriter, you can at least sponsor. We're always looking for help here at BCTV, and that enables us to do the wonderful things that BCTV is all about. If you have any questions, you can always contact me at 610-413-5932. Also, you can donate to to BCTV. Not just money, but you could donate things for the auction. So think about that. Another way, if you don't have the cash, maybe you have something you just need to get rid of and give it to a worthy cause such as BCTV. Watch, like, and share BCTV programs because they are now also found on YouTube. Go into bctv.org on YouTube and you will see all kinds of wonderful programs, including this one. So tell your friends, tell your family, tell the dog, and watch the shows. As long as the dog can press something to say that he watched, that's great, okay? We always say here, change your beliefs, change your life, and you change the world. They say that if you know seven people, you know the world, because those seven people know seven people who know seven people, and so on and so on. So you are important, and the things that you believe and the things that you cherish can be spread. So we can spread love and care and kindness in this world if we so choose. Our next bug program will be Monday, June 18th at 9 p.m., and it's going to be working with angels, especially archangels. So if you are into that, please tune in. And if you're not into it, tune in anyway. Learn something new. Enlighten yourself. Don't just sit there. So that will be on June the 18th at 9 p.m. And it's a live program. And we encourage you to call in at our live program, which is tonight also. We're live here tonight on what date is it? Whatever date it is. We're here now live. And it's Monday night. That's all I know. It's the 21st of May. If you want to call in tonight, feel free to call in at 610-378-0426, and you'll see that on your screen from time to time. Now, U-Cubed, that's where you can find me, and we are on Kutztown Road next to Meyer's Costume, and these are some of the things that we do in June. Hopefully, we're going to show Coco. We've been trying to show Coco for the last 2 months, and we either have an equipment problem or we had no electricity because of that horrible storm that came in this past month. So we're going to try again. And if we don't do it in June, we're not going to show Coco ever again. So evidently there's a message from the universe there, but it will be on 619 from 6 until 8:30 p.m. And it's free. Did I mention that? Free. And there will be popcorn. And it's a wonderful movie. It's all about family. There's also other wonderful things happening at U-Cubed, and this is every week. Mondays from 12 to 1:30, there's a grief group, and it's absolutely free. And it doesn't have to be grief from somebody dying. It can be grief from losing a job or losing a relationship or whatever it is. We also have a women's group from 5:30 to 7 p.m. and an ACA meeting, which is a 12-step meeting for adult children of alcoholics and dysfunctional families. And who of us has not come from a dysfunctional family? So you're more than welcome. We also have weekly meditations from 7:30 to 9 p.m. on Tuesdays, and that's with Dr. Patrick Sulia. It's a quiet meditation. It's a silent meditation from 7:30 until 9. So if you really want to get your chakras in place and get some peace, mind, come on and join us. And that will actually be tomorrow night at 7:30. Costs nothing. So please join us. And on 5/27 from 3 until 6 p.m., there will be a Reiki share. So if you have anything that's out of whack and you want some people to do some energy work on you, again, that's a free thing that we offer. We always accept donations if you like that, but please join us for the Reiki share. And coming soon, we're going to have an EMT, which is Energetic Medicinal Thursdays, also known as Fun Night, and that will be once a month from 6 to 7:30, but it's still in formation. And we're also having a monthly drum circle. And the day and time for that is to be announced because we're looking with the woman that's going to be doing it. We need to know what's good for her. All right. Breath. Okay. Tonight's program. Tonight's program is the Camel Project. Stop Bullying, I Care. And our wonderful guest tonight is Pamela S. Gockley. She's the executive director of the Camel Project, and she is going to elucidate us tonight on what, look that up, and about what the Camel Project is. This is how you can contact her. There's a website, thecamelproject.org, and Pamela Gockley at thecamelproject.org is the email. So please, We'll show this again at the end of the program, and probably during the program it'll flash up on the screen from time to time. But let's take a moment and welcome tonight's guest, Pamela. May I call you Pamela or Pam?
Pam's fine.
Okay, good.
Pam's
That's
fine.
Good. Pammy?
No.
Okay.
No. Not Pam.
So welcome.
Thank you so much for
having me. It's good to have you here. This is a really important topic.
It is.
Especially with the things that we've seen recently in the news again, too.
Yes.
So let's see where you'd like to stop. Start. I'm reading there's a Stop Bullying, I Care, a Bullying Elimination Initiative. Would you like to talk about that first?
Sure.
Or give us some, let's give it some background. Screw that.
Okay.
Let's just give us some background. Tell us a little bit about you and what made you want to do this.
Okay. Well, we've been in business for over 22 years. We've had a marketing business. And everything today is about marketing. It's positioning. It's your marketing message. Who are you? And a lot of times people don't know who they are. So we started with the what we call reputation intelligence. It's a program so you understand what your reputation is, you understand what it needs to be, and you get it there, and then you keep it there. So I've been studying reputation for 12 years.
Yes.
I have written 3 books on it.
Yes, we had you on here for the second one.
You did, and I appreciate that one too.
Oh well, no problem. Yeah. You can kiss the ring.
Yeah. There's no ring.
Oh my God, there's no ring.
Anyway. So based on 12 years of evidence-based learning, about 85% of people say they understand themselves better because number one is having a little bit of self-awareness. So maybe you're doing things that are annoying, or maybe you're doing things that turn people off. So let's start with
And you're not doing it maliciously.
Absolutely not. I was told probably 6 years ago that I have a look. And I'm like, I have a look. So apparently, I'm a dyslexic, so apparently trying to concentrate on what the person was saying, I get a look on my face.
Oh.
So I was told it scares small children.
Oh, cool.
So once I realized I was getting a look because physically I was trying to focus on what they were saying, I was made aware that I made a face. So now I am aware of that, and now I try really hard not to make a face.
And you're able to listen to what they're saying too?
Yeah, I'm working really hard on that.
Okay,
so
great.
Some days are better than others.
Here you go.
So through the self-awareness, confidence building, and making sure you have a very secure network around you. So we talk about first impression. We talk about body language. We talk about communications. How do you communicate? As a dyslexic, for years, I couldn't figure out what was wrong with everybody. They don't understand what I'm saying. What's wrong with these people? Until I realized I wasn't communicating properly.
Mm-hmm.
My head literally goes faster than my mouth.
Mm-hmm.
You know people the other way, that their mouth goes faster than their head. My mind was going, I was on 3 different subjects before they were on the first one. So I understood my communication skills were not, you know, really tight either. And then, you know, you have to have that healthy support system.
And that's important. It has to be a healthy support system.
Healthy
not
support
people
system.
That want to attack you
or
and bring you down.
Or people that agree with you.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, you know, I'm in a meeting. I'm like, y'all agree with me? Somebody's getting in trouble because I am not always right. And, you know, people say that. We want your input. We want to make... And no, they don't.
No.
They don't really. Our customers are number one. No, they're not really. They're really, really not. So after 12 years of being successful for helping people who wanted to get to that next level, or my business is the best kept secret. Well, you know, that's the worst phrase in this, you know, that you could say to me. You know, and my first question is, what are you missing? So if they were totally offended, obviously we wouldn't work together. That would not work.
That's right.
If you're doing everything right, then you're not the best kept secret. Oh, no, wait, you are? Oh, no, wait. So what are you missing?
There you go. Why aren't you bringing in what you need to bring in?
So what happened? Mm-hmm. Those are the types of questions. So as we're, I'm talking to schools, I'm talking to kids, and I'm starting to really connect with kids. I really connect with kids. And I'm like, I got something here. So I had a principal from the Reading School District want to do her thesis paper on dyslexics. So she came to talk to me. It was
for, do you want to tell people what a dyslexic is, just for maybe folks out there
sure.
that don't know what that is?
A dyslexic is somebody who gets numbers mixed up. They get words mixed up. And they have difficulty reading because that's not their way they communicate. So there's a whole range of dyslexics. There's from people who get numbers mixed up every once in a while to people who will never, ever, ever, ever read. And they're everywhere.
So there's a broad spectrum.
Yeah, but people okay. who can't read are everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And what, as a mechanism to survive, you learn how to hide it. And you become a master at hiding the fact you can't read.
And that has a basis of shame behind it.
Absolutely, because, you know,
shame and fear.
You know, drawing or speaking isn't nearly as important as reading and writing,
mm-hmm.
right? But anyway, so, you know, and you know, it depends on the day for me.
Mm-hmm.
Some days is I can't type. You know, I'm typing away and I'm going, there's not a single word on the page.
Wow.
Yeah. And then other days, I'm like spot on. So it just really depends.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, she interviewed me about the dyslexia, and she says, I want you to come in and talk to the Reading High School students. And I'm like, yeah, right, sure, okay. Because a lot of people say stuff that they don't mean. And as a dyslexic, I tend to watch what they do. I don't really listen to what people say. Throwing mm-hmm. a little ADD in there, you know. So I always watch what people do, and I've been, I believe, successful in business because I do that with business as well.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't believe what you're saying, I know it. And a lot of times when I ask, what do you do, and people hee-haw around, you don't know what you do. So we really drill down for, you know, development, and a lot of people don't like that.
No,
they think
it
they
can
know
be intimidating.
It. And, you know, I'm not very good at sugarcoating stuff, if anybody knows me. I just don't really, and again, that's a dyslexic thing. I don't really have time for that. It's really not important. You know, my husband said, I'm amazing because people can do this and this, and it doesn't seem to bother me. It's because what I'm doing is way more important than your problems.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I always said I'm not smart enough to be afraid of anything. And somebody says, well, maybe you're smart enough to not be afraid of anything.
Oh, there you go.
I'm like, wow.
That's a good way of looking at it.
Yeah. So as I'm going through my personal story, people are saying you should write a book. And I'm like, yeah, right. Who cares? You know, mm-hmm. it's my life. You know, it's nothing special. So
who would read this
who
book?
Who would read
right?
this book? And I'm sitting writing going, this is stupid. I can't believe anybody's going to actually read this book. So lo and behold, the principal calls me and said, I want you to come and talk to the students. And it was really the first time I talked about my life story. It's the first time I really talked about what happened to me growing up. And it wasn't that I was ashamed of it. I really didn't think it was that important.
Spectacular, yeah.
And I am not doing this for the glory of telling my personal story. Mm-hmm. It's not an ego thing. It was actually painful to write the book. But what it was very therapeutic. Mm-hmm. I had forgotten some things, and things really started to make sense. It was a personal journey. So I encourage everybody to write your personal book. You don't have to publish it, you know, but really go through that process of writing that book. I had a really good editor. People are like, how do you write books? It's called editors. Get a really good one. He put me in order because as a dyslexic, I sent him probably three chapters. I had one that was doubled and I had it in the wrong order. I always do it backwards.
Okay.
So even on my first book, my first chapter was my last chapter.
Oh, there you go.
It had to be totally flipped.
There you go. I see you have your book next to you.
I do.
Let's, you know, can you get a camera on that or? Can you zoom in on that so that they can see? There you go.
So when I was talking to the students and how
Where can you get this book, by the way?
It's actually on Amazon, or you can go to the website.
Okay.
It's actually a Kindle, it's a print, and it's also audio.
Wonderful.
So if you are dyslexic, it is...
You can hear it.
It's written in 14 font. It's 1.5 alignment for a dyslexic. There is a dyslexic font.
Excellent.
And it's about 100 pages, and there are no really complex sentences. And if there's a big word, I explain it.
Very cool.
So it was written by a dyslexic for a dyslexic, but anybody can read it.
There you go.
So when I was with the Reading High School students, I just connected with them, and it just told me, Pam, you have got to do this. You have got to write your story. So I wrote the book, and then it's called Not All Camels Are in the Desert. And then we have the Camel Project. So are you getting a theme here with
I
camels?
I am getting a theme. And I'm just before we go on any further, what you mentioned about writing your story, that's so important. That's one of the things we do in therapy is get a person to write their story. Mm-hmm. And as you're doing that, you find out, as you said, things start to come to mind that you never thought about. You start connecting the dots, you know, connect the dots, la, la,
yeah,
la.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That kind of thing. Yeah. And it's very insightful. And we have too many people that are walking around on this planet that have no clue who they are.
Well, and it's we're in such a shallow time period right now. We don't go any deeper than the a dime. We don't go any deeper, and I think that's a lot of the issues.
Yeah.
So if you can't write it, everybody has a cell phone. Record yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's a lot of software that. You can talk into it, and it writes it. Well, I'm a Pennsylvania Dutchman. Those things do not work with. They do not work for me. I can. So I did a lot of recording, and when the editor would call me and go, I have no idea what you're talking about. He would interview me.
Oh, there you go. Great.
So then he could. You know, you get a good editor, and you can write a book. And again, you don't have to publish it.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's the journey itself.
It is the journey. So as I'm doing this book, I talk about I was being bullied, the depression, the anxiety, the felony, you know, just the
drugs.
Just drug dealing, just that kind of stuff. And people are like, I never knew that about you. And I'm like, yeah, and didn't really share that part. Didn't really think it was that impressive. So I quit school in ninth grade, and looking back, it was because I was a undiagnosed dyslexic. The school put me in a special ed section, and which is the worst thing you can do to a dyslexic, because we usually have really high IQs.
Mm-hmm.
So as the frustration and the anger, and you know, you basically were isolated. Which is the second worst thing to do to a dyslexic. I became
pigeonholed.
I became so angry and so frustrated. There was I was all by myself. We had an hour bus ride, and the bus just became the bane of my existence. The bus driver didn't like me. She had a fight with my brother. So of course, she didn't like me either. So I ended up destroying the bus, the interior of the bus.
Wow.
Only because of frustration. And again, the thing of it is, it wasn't logical. Of course it wasn't logical. It was a 12-year-old dealing with an adult problem without the equipment. So I just thought there was more. There had to be more. So we started the Camel Project. The Camel Project is a nonprofit, 501c3, and our first initiative is Stop Bullying, I Care. Because we really believe...
Which brings us back to that slide that we talked
about.
Yeah,
we really believe that bullying is a gateway behavior and a gateway effect. So I really think that people who bully have been bullied.
Oh, absolutely.
And people who are the bullied, they have self-awareness issues because there are certain things that bullies look for. I had all seven of them.
Oh, okay. Can you share the seven?
I hope I can remember all. Like, just being different, whether you're smaller than normal, whatever normal is, if you wear glasses, if you have braces, if you're not wearing the right kind of clothing, and
too short, you're too tall.
Too tall, whatever. If you're just extrovert, if you're, shy, if you don't have those designer clothing on, and when you go to consignment shop and buy used clothing, they usually don't fit. Then they don't fit either, because you get close and that's what you get. Or you have the hand-me-downs.
Oh, there you go.
And worn clothing. So, and again, I'm not saying you have to go buy expensive clothing, but just be aware of that.
Mm-hmm.
And that might be it, because what happens is when you're bullied, what happened to me, I was all alone. It wasn't happening to anybody else but me. And somehow it was my fault.
Did you... Now, when you say it wasn't happening to anybody else other than you, was that really true, or was that just your belief?
That's just my belief, because I didn't have that support system.
Okay. I just wanted to clarify that, because there might be people that would misunderstand that.
Yeah, and teachers seem to miss it a lot, so there was no backup. There was nothing. So
it's really hard for teachers to see everything.
I think this
is a community thing. This is a family thing. This is a community thing. We have to come together as that little village.
And that's one of the big initiatives, is starting a community bullying committee. And I've been talking to the county to start
one. Well, you said that a community bullying committee. It just image I'm getting is not, I think, what you're trying to project.
Probably not. I would say no. But a committee that really focuses on that.
Yes, pays attention.
And the first thing we need to do is define it. Nobody even knows what bullying means anymore. You're bullying me. No, it's bullying is a continuous, repetitive, overpowering of somebody and using either their size to overwhelm or overpower people.
It can also be done on a psychological level,
absolutely.
Where silence, giving a person silence.
Mm-hmm.
We call it silent violence because the person that's getting it, you feel like you're being beat up, but what can you complain about?
Yeah.
Nobody's talking to you.
And it's
so it's your imagination. You're too sensitive.
Yes.
Get over it.
You're too sensitive. It's boys being boys. It's the locker room.
It's always the boys being boys.
It's the locker room talk.
It's the girls. They're just catty.
Well, and here's the thing. It's gotten to the point where kids are dying.
Yes.
Kids are committing suicide. The second leading cause of death between 10 and 14 is suicide.
Yes.
So it's not disease, it's suicide. So this has just been ratcheted up, I believe, in the last couple years. I mean, let's just look at our elected officials.
Exactly. I mean, I've never seen, quote, adult people act insanely.
Yeah, and it's
insanely rude.
It's empowering.
The comment
people.
That was made about McCain. Mm-hmm. Well, he's going to die anyway.
And so
who says that kind of stuff?
Yeah, a bully.
I guess so. Yeah.
With permission in that environment.
Yep.
And it's just taking everything to a level I don't like.
So let me ask you this question, because we're mentioning about the bullying that is going on and is seen in the news.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. How, as a parent or a grandparent, do you counteract that? Because if you say to the child, well, that was really a cruel thing to say, or that was hurtful, mm-hmm. or whatever, and then they see this from our elected officials,
mm-hmm.
how do you rectify that? How do you make that connection?
Well, in my opinion, it's having a lot of discussion from a lot of different people. And like you said, it is a community problem. The business owners have to come together. The community leaders have to come together. The schools, the superintendents, the teachers, the parents, and most of all, the kids. because I don't believe adults can fix this problem because they really kind of suck at it. I really think if we empower the kids, they will solve it because they know what's happening. I spoke to a middle schooler at Muhlenberg who was telling me where the cameras don't record in the school. So as I picked up his mother off the floor, because I'm a peer, these kids tell me things like that. So that's why this program is so important. I'm not an educator. I'm not some adult telling these kids what they should do or how they should feel. As I go in, we don't judge people. We judge the decision-making process they're using. There is no judgment. I've never done that. As a dyslexic, I don't have time to do that. That would take some energy, and I don't have time to do that.
And, I mean, according to science, a person's brain doesn't fully develop until they said age 25, and now they're saying age 30. Isn't that wonderful to know?
Wow.
So we're dealing with people who have access to automobiles, to all kinds of adult-ish type rights. Mm-hmm. That are also, they're not emotionally and mentally ready for that.
Well, and can you imagine a kid going to school, getting the same message? What happened? Not what's wrong with you. They don't know what's wrong with you. These kids are starting, you know, through the STEM programs, they're starting pre-kindergarten science projects. Yeah. But yet by fifth grade, these kids are burned out without the essential skills to survive, because they're on their phone or their iPad and they're not even speaking to one another. So imagine if you lived in a community, and I grew up in a really small community, you just didn't do anything wrong because everybody knew.
Yeah, right.
Everybody knew who you were. You know, the room did not change when we entered it. You had to change to be an adult. Having a temper tantrum on the floor, you just would never have done that because you got the look.
Yes.
So you just don't do it. But you got, imagine if you get it from the school. You got the same verbiage, the same mindset. You get it at home. You get it from the corner store owner. You have that same message to these children. That's about my opinion, that's how it's going to be solved. It's a community issue. Mm. People go, well, the schools aren't doing very good. Okay, so what are you doing? And that's what I'm doing. I am stepping up. I am putting this program together. It isn't a pilot program. I have a high school. I've been talking to the Boys and Girls Clubs, talking to elementary school. They want kindergarten through fourth grade to start. So I have a children's book. I wrote a children's book.
Oh, there you go.
That should be out in August. I was very excited about that.
Very cool.
Because I write, you know, nonfiction.
Yeah.
So that was my first attempt at a children's book. So I have a couple 15-year-olds illustrating it for me. I can't wait to see what they come up with.
So how can we, as a community here, help with this?
Well, there's a couple things that we have. There's a list of 10 things, and I know I'm not going to remember all of them, but they're on the website. One of the most important things you can do is we have a town hall. Mm-hmm. So you can, if you... you can invite, you know, 6 people to your home. You can rent a room at the local hotel and get a big event, you know. And
you could come to U-Cubed.
You could come to U-Cubed.
And we could have some people there. We could have 20 people there.
And we could get and start the conversation on how to build a bullying committee that in your community will take this issue on, will define bullying, will... figure out where you are right now, define it, and then develop it. We have to develop it for policies and procedures. So not only what does bullying mean, what happens? You know, what happens when you're bullied? What happens when you're bullied? I asked a person in another school, what do you do when you're bullied? And he had to go to the principal's office to get a piece of paper to fill it out. I'm like, you have to go ask? I was bullied. Can I have a piece of paper? You think that happens? Probably not.
You know, it's interesting because when I was working down in the Bensalem area, and they asked me to come and work with, at that time, the goths, okay?
Yes.
The kids, none of the teachers wanted them in their classes for that, you know, 45 minutes. So they sent them to me. And what I found was really delightful, intelligent people, very bright people.
All you gotta do is talk to them.
Exactly.
It's amazing.
Yeah. Exactly. And one of them came in one day, well, he wasn't a goth, and he came in and he said that he had been suspended from school for 2 days. And I said, well, why? And he told me. And he told me what the teacher had said to him, which was highly inappropriate. And of course, he reacted with, you know, aggression toward what the teacher said. And of course, he got taken out for 2 days. And I said, okay, well, what happened to the teacher? And he said, nothing. And I said, oh, okay, all right. So we worked on a little, I gave him just one little tidbit. And I said to him, the next time that teacher, evidently you said a lot of that to a lot of people. I said, the next time he says something to you like that, just stop, take a deep breath, and say, that's interesting, I'll take a look at that. And he thought that was crazy, but he went on his way, and he came back in a couple days later and said, that teacher started again with me. And I said, what'd you do? And he said, I stopped, I took a deep breath, and I said, that's interesting, I'll think about that. And I said, what did the teacher do? And he said, he moved on to somebody else.
Exactly, and bullies do that. So if you learn how to counteract mm-hmm. the bully, I was helping, I think he's an eighth grader, and he had to go into the principal's. And what happened is he has a really bad reputation for getting into trouble.
Oh, yeah.
So now everything's heightened yep. around him. So the minute he breathes wrong, boom, he's suspended.
It's escalating, yeah.
So, you know, he has to take ownership for not mm-hmm. being aware of his reputation. And he's, you know, as soon as something happened, it's his fault. And that's your reputation. So he had a meeting with them, and I said, what would you normally do? And he said, I would normally just sit and look at my feet. I said, you don't want to really freak them out? I said, look at them in the eye. Mm-hmm. They won't know what to do with you. And I said, be very quiet. And I always go, think, act. And his mother called me and said he did really good.
Good.
With the eye contact. And I was like, do something different. Be quiet.
Mm-hmm.
Don't talk. They are baiting mm-hmm. you into mm-hmm. this. So be smart and don't react.
Don't go into the trap.
Because they know exactly how they have you pegged.
And if you do not react, many times that person might try to up the ante mm-hmm. to see if they could really get to you. And mm-hmm. so, and again, it takes fortitude. It takes grace to be able to just stop and breathe.
How many 12-year-olds are equipped with that?
I know.
It's just, and again, I don't want to act like I'm against the teachers.
Oh, no.
I think the teachers, and right now, it's at the end of the year.
God bless the teachers.
They're all really annoyed with each other at this point.
They just want the year to be over.
Exactly. So.
And teachers have a lot on their plate because they have to juggle what mm-hmm. the school board says, what the superiors, the principal and vice mm-hmm. principal say, mm-hmm. what the parents have to say. I mean, they have a whole contingency of people. And their hands are many times tied, and they can do nothing because there is no cooperation
right.
that is happening.
Well, and that's
that.
we're offering to come in during detention times. We're offering this program through your school. So if you have a child who is, you know, struggling with this topic, you know, get me into the school. Introduce me to the principal.
I think we have a home viewer.
Okay, awesome.
All right, welcome, home viewer.
Hello.
Hello.
This is Robin Gray.
Oh, hi, Robin. I know Robin. Do you know Robin?
Yeah, it sounds familiar.
Yeah, you don't know me. I'm one of the board members of the Camel Project. And when you all were talking, just a couple things. Do you think that social media is also playing a big role with an increase in bullying, where the bullies can actually hide behind and torment the children even more than if it's in person?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, and it's taken it to a new level. I mean, imagine when we were kids and we left school, it was gone, mm-hmm. right? We were done. This
right.
is 24/7.
And it's faceless many times.
And my suggestion is get off social media, but
yeah.
no one likes to hear that part. Get off Facebook. But yeah, absolutely. It's just adding another dimension. And again, that, you know, again, that's causing kids to kill themselves. I really need to do something.
It's and kids killing other kids. You know?
Right. Well, and we also see it when I do in law practice. I see it a lot with kids going through custody. Mm-hmm. You know, battles. Ooh. And sometimes even what they get put through by their school and actually by their parents, not knowing what they're doing.
And I'm very sensitive to that issue also. Yes. Because a child needs more than just a clean house.
Right.
A child needs a house where they feel comfortable. A child needs a family too. And to be kept away from family members that are positive for them, even if the family members don't get along, that's when we have to go to the next step and say, I'm going to be the adult here. I might not get along with this family member, but my child, it's okay for my child to know their relatives.
Well, and sometimes kids are just used as a pawn.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, and it's
just all about the ego of the parents, really.
And I don't know if they really understand the damage they're doing to the kids.
I don't think they do. I don't think it's done, I'm going to screw this kid up. I think it's done because of ego.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Well, oh, absolutely. It's not, a lot of times they don't know they're doing it to the children, but they do, but that's also a type of, as you would say, bullying.
It
you
is.
Know, because they don't know what they're doing, and the effects on the children are years.
And then the children act out. The children
right.
act out, and then they think, oh, what's wrong with this kid? And it's
yeah.
like, hello.
And then they might become the bullying.
Yeah.
You know, they might become the bully because they don't know where to take out that aggression.
And all these all these school shooters, I have to say, I was there when I was being bullied in high school. I don't want to think what would have happened if I would have had access or believed in guns. But yeah, the frustration, and it's not logical. It's not, you're not in a right state of mind when you're being bullied. So leaving it up to the educators and leaving it up to the professionals in education to solve this, they're totally logical. And what these kids are going through, you know, they feel alone.
Yeah.
They're the only ones. And
nobody understands.
And yeah, and it's my fault. So.
Yep.
So they take all the guilt on it. And again, part of the town halls would be discover which part you want to focus on.
And nobody's here, we're not here to blame anybody.
No.
Or any. We're saying, hey, let's work together and let's find.
I'm blaming everybody.
Oh, okay.
Well, everybody. Everybody is responsible. It's not their kid. It's our kids.
Right.
It's not them. It's
That's
us.
Right.
So
That's right.
it can't be them.
I love her laugh. Did you hear that little...
She knows I'm getting wound up now.
She just came here with the poker just to sort of poke the fire a little bit.
Well, me, I would never just go poke. No, not me. But thank you. Like I said, this is all very, obviously, I'm a proud board member of the Camel Project, and it's awesome.
This is very timely. Yeah. Thanks for your phone call.
Thanks for calling in.
Welcome.
So besides having a board meeting, you can introduce me the school superintendents or principals. You can donate money. You can buy somebody a book and share the book because we really do believe that bullying is a gateway behavior.
Maybe the book should be put on a book list, a reading list.
Wow, that would be an awesome idea. But also, you know, and to commit and volunteer. We have a training program for you can become certified as a bullying, the Camel Project bullying specialist.
I'm going to be the devil's advocate here.
Okay.
In this day and age, with everything that's going on, the social media, the technology, people losing their jobs, people having a couple jobs because they can't afford to just live with just one job, parents are really extended too with regard to, they're just trying to make ends meet, and then they say, oh, I don't have time to deal with this.
Mm-hmm.
And I understand that, and I can understand that's not a bad thing to say. However, that's when we go back to the village idea.
Mm-hmm.
that we have to then have people that we can, we have to let go of some of the control, that which is false. We don't have control. Mm-hmm. That's just an illusion. Mm-hmm. But to actually have, you know, like they've done research with the mindfulness with kids in Chicago. Mm-hmm. And the kids, when they have detention, they use the mindfulness. And that's a wonderful thing to teach children.
No, they just sit there now.
I know.
They don't do anything. There's no structure.
Well, that's it. And it's so good to use some of, you know, some of the techniques that we've talked about on this show, that we've, mm-hmm. you know, displayed on this show too, where getting someone to quiet that mind, yep. in a healthy way. Mm-hmm. We have to get people on board with that.
And
we have to teach people other techniques of how to deal with life on life's terms.
Can you imagine a kid needs you to talk to them?
Yeah. What a concept.
Really? Seriously. They want to feel as part of something.
Mm-hmm.
And if the community is at odds, if everything they see on TV is at odds,
yeah.
and all they're doing is playing with their PlayStation or whatever, or their iPad, that's solitary.
Solitary confinement, actually.
And you know, I see parents, and I don't have children because it's too complicated. I decide, and it's not that I can't. It's I decided a long time ago when I was 12 to not have children because I can't deal with it.
Well, because of what you were going through, too.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it affects everything.
And I was never going to get married, but we were together like 30 years, so that one didn't work out. But the kids, yeah. It's very complicated.
So what I'm hearing you say is that bullying is a gateway behavior.
Absolutely. And it's also a gateway effect.
Yes.
Because people who are bullied go into the workplace and continue to be bullied. And people who were bullies usually are the boss who are now bullying everything. So, and you know, millennials are not going to put up with this nonsense. So this is why they keep moving employment, because they don't put up with that.
They don't want to put up with that at all. So we have one slide. I see that we have 7 minutes left, technically, 7-ish minutes left. So let's just talk about this quickly. And I'm sorry that we're doing it so quickly. Oh, we got 5 minutes. We got 5 minutes. Talk fast.
Okay.
We'll both talk
okay.
at the same time.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, no, and I just put this together because I think bullying is the center of it. And it's abuse, violence, isolation, criminality, addiction, depression, suicide. And I think those are really huge problems. So if we nip it in the bud and cure the bullying and eliminate it, and I truly believe kids in power can eliminate the bullying in one generation.
That would be wonderful.
I really do believe it, if we allow them to do it.
If you want to change a society, you really have to start with the children.
Yeah, I gave up on the adults. No. Yeah. No. We have a workplace bullying program too, but along the same lines.
Oh, where was that workplace bullying when I was working at some place?
Everybody
that
says that.
I'm not going to mention.
Everybody says that. Where were you when I was working? I was being bullied. But yeah, I really, this is my passion. This is, and I need people to support it. I need financially. We don't want to burden with the after school programs or the schools with the funding. So we're looking for corporate sponsorships. We're doing a fundraiser in October because it's Bullying Awareness Month. So I just need the community to solve this problem. This is not a Pam problem. This is not a them problem. This is an us problem.
Well, one thing I will say now, without conferring with my business partners, but I think it would be great for us to have something at U-Cubed and put it out there, get people in the community to come in. Maybe we can get some of the local politicians in mm-hmm. there, too. So, I mean, we have to educate everybody.
Absolutely.
You know, this is something that affects all of us.
And this program is ready to set into place.
That's
great.
We
just need people in the community who will...
That's wonderful.
...commit to taking care of it.
All right. Well, let me wrap this up.
I know, I can't believe it was an hour.
I know.
Goodness.
I don't know. I think they were playing with the cards and
I
the
think
clock
so
on
too.
Us.
These are new guys.
So let's just go to a quote that I have here. It says, "There is always something we can do. All we need to do is recognize we are responsible for everything we are feeling, and just by working on ourselves, we can change things. And I just thought that was apropos for what we were talking about tonight.
That's perfect.
Think about it. Again, this is, I want to thank Pamela for being here tonight, and contact her. I thought I had her information on the next page. No, I didn't. You'll have to go back. Remember that you are a human being, not a human doing.
Yes.
Because many of us think what we do is important. Remember to be gentle with yourself, because if you are not gentle with yourself, who is going to be? And this show will re-air on Wednesday, 5:23 at 11 a.m., Friday, 5:25 at 4 p.m., and Sunday, 5:27 at 1 p.m. Tell your friends, tell your neighbors. Watch this show. Watch it again and again. And it can also be seen on bctv.org, in the archives, and also on YouTube. So please like what you see on YouTube. The next bug program is June the 18th at 9 p.m. It's Working with Angels. Very fascinating woman, Petra. She will be here to talk about that. She has lots of information to share with you. And again, like, watch, and share BCTV programs on YouTube. I can't say that enough. I'm a broken record. And this is a little girl's creation. And again, Madeline, I love you. Grammy is with you at all times, whether we're physically together or not. And so is Pop-Pop. And with that, let's just sort of come back here and wave our goodbyes and say thank you so much to Berks County for tuning in.
Absolutely.
All 10 of you. So we want to, or maybe 11. So we'll do the we'll do the queen wave, since the wedding was yesterday. This is the queen wave.
Yeah, if half of those people would be willing to donate and work with bullying, we would cure this thing.
You know, that's not a bad idea, because
that's a whole other topic.
Him and his brother are really into that stuff. We should talk to them. So is their mother, Diana. So thank you so much for tuning in. Have a great month. We'll see you next month. Be the best windshield you can be. Good night, Berks
Bye-bye.
County.
Some days you're the windshield, some days you're the bug is supported in part by U-Cubed Body, Mind, Spirit.